Hi, my name is Cody and I'm with LaunchDarkly. We often think about LaunchDarkly in the context of very visual platforms, things like web applications or a web page that you're visiting. Maybe you want to turn on a specific section of that page, so we wrap it in a feature flag. When it's enabled, you see the object. When it's disabled, it's gone. And you use that to target specific users with that change. Those very same development concepts apply also to the way we design and roll out new versions of APIs, which are typically programmatic interfaces that the developer team and integration team work with when they're building out these larger applications. These APIs effectively become building blocks of the application itself. So we would still want to be able to perform those same progressive rollouts, the same targeted rollouts, the deployment and rollback capabilities that we love so much in LaunchDarkly with those APIs as well. In this video, we're going to look at a Python-based API that interacts with the database, and we're going to look at how we can expand its functionality using LaunchDarkly. It's going to be a lot of fun, so let's jump in. On the left-hand side of the screen, we have our application. It's a Python-based Flask API that interacts with the database. So in this database, we add our slash users path. We're able to get information out of the database and post new information to it. It's very basic and just interacts with the local database on my system. We also have the slash API route that returns back if it's healthy and what the version is. On the right-hand side, we have Insomnia, which is an API client. So we'll be using this to interact with the API to make those calls and see how it's changing when we start to implement LaunchDarkly. I've already brought in the first part of LaunchDarkly, just importing the LD client and setting up the initial configuration. We're also going to need the SDK key as we start to instantiate the different client objects. So we'll switch over into LaunchDarkly. We'll do our command K and copy our SDK key for the current environment. And we'll copy our server-side SDK key. We're going to just create a variable at the top that has this API key. Typically, we'd want to set this up as like an environment variable or something along those lines. But in this case, for the demo, we can go ahead and just save it here. So we have our key in place now, so we can actually start to create our user object, which I have nifty saved off to the side, which just gives us a default anonymous user for now. So this API is fairly basic right now. Let's look at how we can bring LaunchDarkly in to do some useful stuff with it. Oftentimes, we'll take APIs offline to make some changes, to add enhancements. Towards the end of this demo, we're going to add in a delete function at the end of, or delete method at the end of this API call. And we'll want to have the API offline while we start to do that so that we can make these changes safely without people calling things as we're doing work on the back end. So I think doing a maintenance mode is a great way to bring a feature flag capability in. If the maintenance mode's enabled, the API is not going to function. It's going to return a status message indicating it's currently in maintenance. If it's disabled, it'll go ahead and run as needed. So let's go ahead and pop in here to this route, and we will go ahead and bring in our configuration. LD client, and we'll use the set config, and that config takes in the SDK key object that we created. So we'll just use LD key right there. And then we're going to do a variation or evaluate a variation. A variation is a flag value. So we'll go ahead and do mode for the variable name. And we'll name this one mate mode. We'll bring in our user object that we did earlier. And by default, we'll have this be false. So this will return back a true or false based on the value of the flag inside of LaunchDarkly. So in this case, we'll go ahead and wrap this in an if-then statement. So if that is true, it'll return back our status message. But if it's false, it'll run the API call as we wanted it to. So if mode is equal to true, we're going to return out a status message that says maintenance mode enabled, API offline. Go ahead and correct our capitalization there. And then we'll use Jasonify to return that status, so we get that back in the UI. From here, we can then do a else to return this portion of the code. So again, just to highlight what we're doing here is we've configured our LB client with the key. We're evaluating a flag named mate mode that'll evaluate to true or false. If that maintenance mode is enabled, we return back the status. Otherwise, we go ahead and let it make its call. So for now, what we're going to do is we're going to start making this API call. Insomnia has this really great feature that lets us do an interval. So this is currently running. So you can see it's pulling 3 users out of the database. I'm going to save the changes to this configuration. Things are looking good. And we're going to go in and create a flag named mate mode. So it'll switch back into LaunchDarkly, create our flag. We'll do enabled, disabled. So that flag is currently off. We can see things are still running here. We'll go ahead and turn this on for everybody. And we can see that we're now receiving the maintenance mode is enabled and API is offline. So just switching that flag, turn this on and had the code evaluate differently now that that's on. So we have our maintenance mode enabled. Let's go ahead and look at bringing in that delete function I talked about earlier on. Maybe we would ultimately want to gate that delete function around a user. Since it's a new capability, we want to be able to test it against a specific user group. So like our dev users are able to use that delete function out of the gate and see if it works. And if it does work, we go ahead and roll that into production. So we're going to add on a new method here in our Python code called delete. And down here towards the bottom, we're going to start to scaffold out this function. So request method equals delete. We're going to do some things. And ultimately, I have that code handy available off to the side. So I'm going to grab that code and bring it in real quick. So that functionality is there now, but we want to go ahead, as I mentioned, and gate this around a user. So we need a way to actually evaluate a user. Right now we're evaluating an anonymous user, so everyone is treated the same. For the sake of simplicity, I'm going to set this up to use the headers as an authentication method. So if headers present, we can use that to evaluate off of. Typically you'd have like an authentication system that would handle this and we just tie into that, but this is a simple way to show authentication in place. Once again, I'll bring in another little bit of code here that creates us a new user object. So this replaces the user object that we had above. What we're doing here is we're creating a name variable off of the request headers, group off of the group header, and then instantiating that user object. From here, we're going to create another feature flag. We'll call it delete enabled. We'll use our new user object. And we'll want this disabled by default, just in case. We'll set up our if-then statement just like we did before. So if delete enabled equals true, we let this new code that we brought in execute. If it's not, we'll create a new object. Delete is not currently enabled. And then again, just like before, we'll return the JSON version of that status message. Go ahead and save this. We can see our call is still running. Our maintenance mode is currently still offline. We're going to go ahead and go create this flag now. Switch back into our feature flags view, create a flag. We'll call this one delete enabled. Again, it's Boolean true or false. We go enabled or disabled. We'll add a little bit more of a description in. This flag enables the experimental delete API. Save that flag. It's currently set to off. So we need to go ahead and add in a user target. Now, if we go into users, we can see that I've used this user before. We can see that Kodi object comes in and has a groups dev. So I can say dev users get this configuration. Let's go ahead and hop back into delete enabled. And let's target a user who matches these rules because we want to be able to grab a group of users or a configuration of users. So we'll go ahead and do groups. Starts with dev and set it to enabled. But for everybody else, we want this disabled. We'll turn on targeting here. We'll save our changes. So that targeting is currently enabled and that maintenance mode is overriding everything inside of here. So right now we can't call that delete method because this is offline. So what we'll go ahead and do is we'll disable our maintenance mode real quick. So we'll pop back in here, feature flags. Turn off maintenance mode. Our queries are running again. We'll stop this configuration. Now I already have this header set up. I'm going to disable that dev header for now though. We're going to go down to delete. This delete takes in an object. So we'll go ahead and tell it we want to delete ID number 3 and we'll send it. And now because I disabled that header, delete's currently not enabled. If I go ahead and turn that header on, check that box so that's going through now and hit delete. We can see that delete was successful. If I go back to get users now, we should see less users than before. Exactly, because that third user has been deleted. In this video, we showed how you can iterate on the development of an API in the same way that you iterate on the development of a web application. We are able to add new functionality behind feature flags and expose those functionalities to end users. If there was a problem, we could roll that functionality back and it would be like it was never there in the first place. We also brought in the concept of identity and user targeting. So we were able to target specific users to be able to consume a specific part of our API based on the membership to a group they had. Using identity in this way is how you create massive scale in the way you roll out features and functions to your end users. Really hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something new and looking forward to visiting with you again soon. Take care.